Hello, I'm Rick Fonsice. Welcome to Rainier Country, a close-up on the communities in the shadow of Mount Rainier. In this edition, DuPont remembers its heroes lost in the battle against terrorism. In Puyallup, a little box tackles a big problem. We'll also see how two Rainier Country towns are remembering their past. And check out Tiny Orting's new slogan that thinks big. Plus, reusing, reducing, and rethinking in University Place. And why this spot at Chambers Creek Properties could be the perfect place to tie the knot. It's all ahead on Pierce County TV's Rainier Country. The town of DuPont is nestled between Joint Base Lewis-McChord and Puget Sound. It might be small in size, but it is huge in patriotism and how it remembers its fallen heroes.
To honor them this Veterans Day, DuPont dedicated a special memorial to its townspeople who've died in the global war on terrorism. 13 people from DuPont who've paid the ultimate price.
Staff Sergeant Conrad A. Mora, killed in action in Afghanistan on 24 July 2010.
The town raised thousands of dollars in donations from people and businesses to build the memorial, and it's not just to honor DuPont soldiers who died in the war on terror, but civilians too, working for private contractors or other government agencies like the CIA. America's smaller, all-volunteer army increasingly depends on non-soldiers to get the work done.
And the vast majority of those are American citizens with great companies that do the things we need, whether it's providing intelligence, doing convoy operations, providing security at our bases, and it's important to recognize that these individuals are also members of this struggle that our nation's in, and very appropriate to recognize them in this memorial.
But soldier or civilian, it doesn't matter. A lost loved one is just as tragic and just as hard on any family, on any community, especially one as small as DuPont, where a good share of its 7,000 residents are either in the service or used to be. That's Wilburn Ross. He's one of just a few World War II Medal of Honor winners still alive, and he lives in DuPont, where the memorial to those killed in the global war on terrorism is located in a plaza named in honor of this humble hero.
I came out here in 1947, so I've been here the rest of my life. Thank you.
A lot has changed since Sergeant Ross fought off invading Germans single-handedly with his machine gun in World War II. Soldiers now see the war on terror as increasingly isolated from the American public. Well, not here in DuPont.
This is a small American community that has taken the effort to really recognize those that have fallen in support of our nation's objectives.
Of course, there are some things that never change from war to war.
No one knows silence like a military family. The silence that remains when a son or daughter goes off to boot camp, or the lingering silence when a father or mother deploys on a long combat deployment, nor the deafening silence when the flag is handed to a grieving loved one who has lost a soldier.
And of course, those loved ones include the young ones left behind, some of whom are so little, they never got a chance to know their dad. But now, they have this wall to help them remember.
It's a place I can bring my son and show him when he's older, since he's not old enough to understand.
Ann Mora lost her husband just last July in Afghanistan. And like other grieving families in DuPont, she takes comfort knowing that others will now remember his sacrifice.
I'm just really thankful. It really touches us right here to know that people honor them instead of forget them, which kind of happens a lot, unfortunately.
But in DuPont, their memories will never be forgotten. Supporters of the memorial say the easiest part of this project was raising the money to build it. In fact, people were so eager to give, there's plenty left over to maintain and upgrade the memorial for the future. So no one ever forgets the sacrifice of the people from DuPont who gave their lives in the global war on terrorism.
No matter how big or small, all communities are struggling with a new threat against families and the environment. Glenda Carino has details on how Puyallup is fighting back against prescription drug abuse.
The marvels of modern medicine are helping us live longer, healthier lives.
But there's a dark side when those drugs fall into the wrong hands or are simply discarded the wrong way. Prescription drug abuse is on the rise everywhere, and Puyallup is no exception.
From 1998 to 2008, there was a 400% increase in prescription drug abuse. That's huge.
And here's another alarming statistic.
Prescription drug overdoses have overtaken car crashes as the number one cause of accidental deaths in Washington state. And it's not just adults.
The Substance Abuse and Mental Health Services Administration put out a statistic recently that said there's been a 17% increase in youth between the ages of 12 and 18, between 08 and 09, with prescription drug abuse.
The problem is simple. It's too easy to snatch pills like highly addictive Oxycontin from unsecured medicine cabinets and drawers. America's drug problem has gone from the street to the bathroom.
That's why we urge people to lock up, secure their drugs if they're currently using them. And if they're not, don't leave them in your medicine cabinet. Don't leave them in a drawer on the counter, because invariably, if they're a high-valued narcotic, they're going to be stolen by an acquaintance, family, a friend, a burglar.
Detectives say the medicine cabinet is the first place burglars go these days. But what if you are done with your drugs and want to get rid of them safely? That's easy. Just pack up your pills and take them to Puyallup Police Headquarters.
They have a disposal box, a safe disposal box. It's open 24/7. They can put it in there and get it out of their cabinets.
Say hello to P2D2, the prescription pill drug disposal box. There's one in Puyallup and at other area police departments. You can drop off your unused prescriptions anonymously. No needles or liquids allowed. Though Puyallup has had the program in place for a year, a National Drug Take-Back Day last September shone a spotlight on the problem here in Pierce County and in communities around the country. The response was astounding.
Here in Puyallup, we received over 50 pounds of unwanted, expired, unused prescription or over-the-counter medicines that people just wanted to drop off. So we provided them a safe, secure way, and it was completely anonymous. They just came into the lobby, threw it in the box, and we take it from there.
The drug drop-off box has become a permanent fixture at Puyallup PD and is used every day. But why not just dump your pills down the toilet or drop them in the trash? Studies have found measurable amounts of narcotics, antidepressants, and antibiotics in drinking water downstream of treatment and disposal sites.
The treatment plants aren't equipped to get all of the, you know, the narcotics, the traces of narcotics out of the drinking water. So this will help, and it's safer than throw it in your trash, because when you throw it in your trash, it can be accessed by pets, other animals, children. So it's just not a safe way to throw it in your trash. It's much safer to deliver it to us so it can be properly incinerated.
Dropping your drugs in a safe disposal box not only helps the earth, it eliminates the lure of an easy high for someone raiding your medicine cabinet. And this advice for parents. With more people dying from pill popping than car crashes, it's important to talk to your teens about the dangers of prescription drugs, even though most kids don't abuse them.
Once we know what the problem is, and once we recognize that there is a problem, then we can do things, we can make a difference, and there is hope.
In Puyallup, I'm Glenda Carino for Rainier Country.
Just up the road from Puyallup is Fife, a community rich in farm history. Laura Potter tells us how Fife is not forgetting its farm heritage.
This 60-year-old farmhouse might seem like any ordinary brick rambler, but it is home to the Fife Historical Society Museum. And one look inside is one long look back at the Fife of yesterday.
For most people, this was kind of a suburb of Tacoma, and the dairy farms, at one time there were 27 Swiss and German dairy farms here, and they provided milk, butter, and eggs to the land people in Tacoma, particularly those that had like Weyerhaeuser and Long, and who were fairly wealthy, affluent people and very influential people.
Fife was named for Lieutenant Colonel William J. Fife, and there's a room in the museum dedicated to him and the other early settlers from Europe and Asia. But of course, they weren't the first farmers of Fife.
The Indians basically lived along the river here. They did raise wild celery, wild onions, and a type of squash. They fished the river. There's just so much history here.
The Fife Historical Museum honors the vast diversity of the valley, where farmers from Italy, Switzerland, and Japan worked side by side with Native Americans on the tribal land they lease. The hardy farm families of Fife drew strength from the women of the valley, farmers' wives who were honored in one of the museum's rotating exhibits featuring their wedding gowns.
The city of Fife would not have been what it was without the brides coming in, because they really established it and made it what it is today with the beautiful homes and the nice furnishings.
Beautiful crystalware, silver, and other tasteful furnishings mixed with the more utility farm stuff like kitchen gadgets and newspaper clippings. It's all here inside the Fife Historical Museum. Next door is Engine 684. A rebuilt timber train locomotive that used to bring logs through Fife on the way to ships and mills. And no farm town would be complete without a barn. There's a big red one, just restored, also here at the Daca Farm.
Since I've lived here since I was born, I remember the barn when it was a barn. And so, but that's the good thing about it, is it's part of history and it's part of what was here before, and that kind of gets lost over the decades in the transformation of the city.
A barn in appearance only, as volunteers spent a year and a half converting the 56-year-old Daca vegetable barn into a museum piece itself and a community gathering place.
We did an awful lot of arm twisting between myself and former Mayor Kelly. We were able to get a lot of the construction firms involved and that donated labor. The Puyallup tribe donated things to us, and we were able to do it at probably a quarter of what it would have cost to do it any other way.
The work, which included some recyclable material, has made the barn a new source of pride for Fife. But it wasn't always so. Support from the city council ran thin as the barn languished for years in disrepair.
And once that we started working on the barn, the council started coming around. And of course, now that we're done with the barn, everybody on the council is completely on board.
Eventually, the barn will be rented out for events and become a centerpiece for community activities like festivals and sports tournaments. Volunteers are still gathering artifacts for both the barn and the museum. If you have a piece of Fife history you want to share, contact the Fife Historical Society. And to learn more about the rich history of Fife, stop by the museum at Daca Park, open Wednesdays, Fridays, and Saturdays. In Fife, I'm Laurel Potter for Rainier Country.
Neighboring Sumner calls itself the rhubarb pie capital of the world. But as Carmen Palmer tells us, its ties to that sweet stock go far beyond the fields.
Most of us know the old cannery as a giant furniture store and community gathering place. But for some, the place is a trip down memory lane to a time decades ago when fruits and vegetables from around the Northwest found their way to this mammoth building along the White River. The walls no longer reverberate with the clamor of loud canning machinery and conveyor belts, but in the memories of those who worked here, like City Councilmember Leroy Goff, the history of the place lives on.
It seemed like everybody in Sumner worked here. You could come down and get a job if you were willing to work hard. You could keep your job if you didn't.
Some of those workers, like Noni Maza, sat down recently with Dave Radcliffe, the current furniture store's owner, to reminisce.
You started when you were 12 years old?
Yeah, it probably wasn't legal, but my dad was pretty desperate, so.
Noni's dad ran the place during World War II. He was the cannery superintendent and did the hiring and firing.
I remember, our dad was kind of a mean guy to work for as far as working went, because he had a short fuse and he would fire somebody on the spot, and if they came back the next day and said they'd do a good job, well, he'd hire them, but that was your last chance. You never got another chance after that.
Like many other Sumner teens, Noni's brother, Pat Carroll, also worked in the cannery for their dad. He handled everything from peaches to pears, blackberries to raspberries.
They go through and go into cans, and then go back in the back end, and they go in great big
cookers.
Great big cookers. They cook them, and it'd end up, and then it would go into the warehouse, clear in the back to be at the warehouse.
And it wasn't just teenagers who worked at the cannery. Housewives did too, especially during the war. They could be in the middle of a chore at home and get a call to go to work in a way that preceded instant messages and tweets, but was just as effective.
Whenever the cannery would get an overload of stuff, a load of fruits that had come in or something or other, they'd blow a big whistle. And when they blew that whistle, all the women would put all of their housework aside and come running to the cannery and suit up and come in and go to work to get the produce done.
Everyone's life seemed to revolve around Sumner's Cannery in one way or another. And for some of those passing through town, it was a way to get a cheap buzz. Hobos riding the rails would hop off the cars outside the cannery and sneak a sip or two from the vats of fermenting fruit.
You go down there at maybe 4 or 5 o'clock, and they'd all be laying down. they would be fermented. Yeah, it was really something else, really something.
A sign from the side of one of the old delivery trucks hangs on the wall inside. There's a lot of Sumner history here, so it seems a fitting place to remember and look forward. A new visitor center is now coming to the cannery, right next to the fudge counter, where people can learn more about the town, what it was then, and what it is now. Then certainly seems a lot simpler than now, especially when it comes to commuting.
I could get up in the morning and go to work, and driving out this highway out to work, I'd maybe see 3 cars.
Some of the old remains, though, like the spots of solder used to seal the cans, now permanently embedded in the old cannery's wood floor.
But everything changes. It's just like the cannery. I walk in the cannery and holy cats, no machinery, none of that screaming stuff, shakers running and so on, people hollering back and forth.
The noise is gone, and furniture has replaced fruit. But old memories and a new visitor center will keep the history of this place on the minds of many who now come to Sumner. I'm Carmen Palmer for Rainier Country.
This program is all about the communities in the shadow of Mount Rainier. And no town boasts a closer relationship than the city of Orting. And Bill Altman tells us how that town is now capitalizing on that big connection.
Just about anywhere you go in Orting, the mountain is there. It feels close enough to touch. Orting is a town with a $1 million view for everyone. But what it hasn't had is a slogan to call attention to its unique place in Rainier Country. So, the town leaders thought that they'd better do something about that. After all, it might stimulate the economy, too.
In that process, I put together community members. We had a lot of fun. We met at Los Pinos Restaurant. We had about 50 taglines to go over and talk about and ultimately vote on and choose. And we came up with this one.
Small town, big view.
It's a slogan that says it all. The family-friendly town is certainly small. And the view, unquestionably big.
Orting's got a gorgeous view of the mountain. Coming up Highway 162, that mountain just shines on good weather days.
A town slogan, or tagline as it's called in the advertising world, is important to a city, no matter what its size.
If it's a smaller place, then I think it helps both customers relate to the town, and it helps the residents feel a sense of pride and feel something special about where they live.
You've got the Emerald City, the City of Destiny, and perhaps the most famous of them all.
When you say, I'm from Las Vegas, and someone else says, what happens in Vegas stays in Vegas, you know you've hit pay dirt.
So how is Orting's new slogan, small town, big view, playing on Main Street?
I think it's a great idea because people coming into town, the mountain is at the end of the street. It's just tremendous.
It's nice to live here, and you have Mount Rainier and the valley hills on the side, so it's nice.
These folks will also be happy to know their town paid just a small price for the big slogan.
I think the mayor probably spent $30 or $40 herself buying dinner for those of us at Los Pinos.
Where some cities spend thousands on consultants to find just the right line, Orting just tossed around ideas in a restaurant brainstorming session with local volunteers, like business owner John Rendell.
And when all was said and done, everybody kind of had the agreement. You know, everybody had your favorite, but they kind of said that, yeah, small town, big view was going to be the one that was going to work for us.
I think it's terrific. I think it's wonderful. It's authentic. It's suitable.
So the next time you're looking for a
small town, big view,
look no further than Orting, a small place with a cheap slogan that says it all. In the heart of Rainier Country, I'm Bill Oldman.
You know, just like the rest of us at home and at work, we're all trying to save money these days. And one way to do that is to be very careful how we use our resources. In University Place, that's becoming a citywide effort. More from Linda Sees.
The Green Up Initiative in University Place goes beyond City Hall. It involves the whole community, from the fire department to the new civic building to parks and schools.
We have a lot of really wonderful natural resources here, and that's the reason people want to live here. And so we want to make sure that we take steps to ensure that those resources are around for future generations.
Everyone is working to make a difference, including the emergency crews who keep University Place a safe place to live.
What we're doing when we're routinely out in the area and we're stopped at houses for calls is we're shutting off our engines and reducing fuel, reducing pollution. But more importantly, we've had some great compliments from the neighborhood saying the noise reduction is great because, you know, you take two or three rigs and you pile them up in a small neighborhood and diesel engines running for a half hour, it's really a big impact.
Firefighters work 24-hour shifts, so they have a home away from home at the fire department, where they eat, sleep, wash clothes, and wait for alarms. It only makes sense to practice the same sustainability habits they have at home.
And they came to the fire department each day and said, why aren't we doing this here? And so it was really neat to see the employees come together and say, you know, we just can't be throwing batteries away like we used to, and we need to recycle a lot more products. So I was really impressed with that.
But there's more to sustainability than recycling and conservation. This is the Adriana Hess Wetland Park, where University Place Mayor Debbie Klosewski proudly shows off contributions from community members and organizations which portray the outdoor side of sustainability.
We have the compost barrel here that you can just put your yard waste and other materials in and rotate it quite a bit. And one of my personal favorites here that everybody could do at home, you could make a worm bin or a worm box.
The wetland park also shows the latest in rain collection technology. And let's not forget the importance of exercise to sustain each of us a little longer too.
We're trying to get people out of their cars and to exercise and to walk more. And so some of the things we've done, we've actually constructed 23 miles of sidewalks. We've built 20 miles of bike lanes. And so that helps not only with overall health benefits, but helps the environment as well by getting people out of their cars.
Here on Bridgeport Way, work continues on University Place's state-of-the-art civic building, which will include the future City Hall and the new library, which will be LEED certified. LEED stands for Leadership in Energy and Environmental Design, which means there are energy savings and water conservation measures built right in. University Place's head librarian, Cindy Bonero, says the library will be a showplace of sustainability.
Part of being a LEED building is the education of what we've done to our customers. So they'll be able to come in and see the different measures that we have implemented to help with conservation in our new library.
Visitors will see displays and learn about sustainability with inexpensive natural light, low water use restrooms, and solar panels on the roof. Of course, a lot of library users are students, and they've already had a head start on sustainability practices.
Sustainability efforts and practices are very important too, and we've demonstrated that I think pretty well with the new construction that we've had since the passing of our capital improvement bond back in 2006.
At Curtis Junior High, that also means a green building full of conscientious kids who recycle everything from bottles and cans to reams and reams of used paper.
Oh,
Oh, yeah, kids love recycling. It's a lot of fun. It's helping, you know, keep everything green.
Speaking of learning, the city of University Place hosts a variety of workshops on sustainability and has organized a community sustainability committee, which is working on more ways to go green.
Sustainability is really important not only for University Place, but for our entire Puget Sound region.
For more information on volunteering in University Place parks or to get involved in the Green Up initiative, check out the city's website at cityofup.com. This is Linda Sees with Rainier Country.
One of the many scenic wonders that sustainability surely will protect is the Chambers Creek properties. It's a place where we all go to play, and some people go to get hitched.
You know the Chambers Creek properties as a place to hike, beachcomb, or golf at Chambers Bay. But the place is also a launching pad for lifetime commitments. And a place to celebrate them, too.
I think it's, you know, the natural beauty of the area, and you know, the view from this location is about as good as any in Tacoma, and certainly there's something, you know, about a church wedding, but I think being outdoors here with the view and the mountains and the water is, you know, it's a special option here also.
Lately, more and more couples seem to agree with that and have chosen to have their wedding at one of two distinct venues at the properties, the Chambers Bay Golf Course and the Environmental Services Building, or ESB. The number of people tying the knot on these bluffs above Puget Sound has grown steadily since 2002. Of course, last summer's national focus on the U.S. Amateur Championship held here certainly didn't hurt.
You know, it definitely made us a little bit more familiar to people that maybe don't play golf and don't walk the trail. So from that perspective, I think a lot of people saw the big panoramic view on TV and thought, hey, you know, that's a great place to, you know, whether it's a wedding or a family reunion or a lot of functions like that would want to be out here.
But nice as it is, you need more than scenery to make a wedding or reception great. Both facilities have it all, including full kitchen and catering facilities to make the best-looking wedding taste good, too. And amazingly, without the sticker shock that comes with some more expensive venues.
I think we're pretty competitively priced, and we try and make things as easy as possible.
So how much will a Chambers Bay wedding set you back? Well, here's what you can expect. There are package deals that start at $7,000 on weekends and slightly higher on Saturday night. It's cheaper during the work week. And if that's too expensive, Chambers Bay can customize a program to fit your budget, perhaps on a weekday when there's less demand. Go online to chambersbaygolf.com to learn more. At the neighboring Environmental Services Building, where the views are equally spectacular, you can rent the ESB's meeting facility for as little as $1,700 on a peak season weekend. And if you don't need the full facility, a Friday night rental allows you to choose a smaller space and save even more. They have a list of approved caterers, too, for your event. Details are online at piercecountywa.org/event-rental. Chambers Bay also has a list of reputable vendors for ordering things like food, flowers, decorations, and music. The setting at the Chambers Creek properties couldn't be better.
One, two, three.
But what if a picture-perfect sunset isn't exactly in the forecast? Our camera caught one ceremony in the rain, which didn't seem to dampen anyone's spirits.
Rain or shine, yeah, we've done a handful of ceremonies inside the pavilion there where we just kind of move the tables and make an aisle in between there, and really is surprising even to me how beautiful it can look inside there. And, you know, almost not quite as good as the view here, but certainly we've had nothing but great experiences when we have to move it inside.
Rain or shine, it's never too early to book your wedding at either Chambers Bay or the Environmental Services Building. Dates for next year are filling up, including summer, but there's still space. If you're interested, the staff at Chambers Bay and the ESB are always eager to meet and show you how your wedding can be just as special as the place that hosts it.
Not a bad place to get hitched, no.
Pierce County's Chambers Creek properties, just another one of the many special treasures in Rainier Country. I'm Rick Van Sice. Thanks for visiting. We'll be back soon with another visit to Rainier Country.